When you start off, nobody wants you there. You're just a damn nuisance. Just another kid who's wanting to go on the stage. And probably not very good either.
I mean, if you want to be an actor, you'll be an actor. If you think you might like to be an actor, you won't be an actor. I mean, you've got to actually desperately want it.
I had no idea of the difficulties and the problems ahead. Just none. You don't know about life when you're 17.
St Martin's Lane in London, home to the prestigious Noel Coward Theatre, which in 1984 was known as the Albury Theatre, and where veteran British actor Sir Anthony Quayle was appearing in The Clandestine Marriage alongside the great comic actor Roy Kinnear. That summer, I recorded extended radio interviews with them backstage here in the Star dressing room. They spoke at length about their experiences getting established in the theatre and passed on a wealth of advice for those wanting to follow them into the profession.
Unless there is nothing else on earth that will satisfy you, don't do it.
You've got to actually be prepared to put acting or the theatre or getting a job before anything else.
I want to explore the many challenges that now face today's emerging actors, see how much of Anthony's and Roy's seasoned advice has stood the test of time, and find out just what it's going to take to make it in this rapidly changing profession. To help us, we'll hear firsthand the views and experiences of recent graduates from the UK's highly acclaimed National Youth Theatre.
I think something like the rep, certainly National Youth Theatre, is that they have connections to professionals that enlighten you about what the industry is and what it's like and how hard it can be.
You know, you can't sort of let yourself run away with it because you know, come the end of the run, you're back to square one essentially, and you have to look for work again.
And the head of drama and head of casting at Lime Pictures, one of Britain's leading TV production companies, offer contemporary insights from within the entertainment industry and help point out some of the many mistakes that new actors can make when trying to get established.
When I sit in casting sessions, 90% of the people we see we probably don't want and aren't right. So I feel that if you are one of the lucky few who has that natural talent, you will break through if you are passionate enough about it.
Casting directors, agents, producers, directors are much more accessible than they used to be. You know, back in the day it was you'd send hard copy letters and hope that it would arrive on the desk. Actually now, more often than not, you can get access to a casting director's email.
Today, the Noel Coward is owned by Delphont Macintosh Theatres. Their chief archivist, Rosie Runciman, is custodian of the theatre's impressive history.
Well, this beautiful theatre opened in 1903 with a production of Rosemary. It was designed by the notable theatre architect William Sprague. We took over the running of this theatre in 2005, and we did some refurbishment straight away. And at that juncture, in June 2006, the theatre was officially renamed the Noel Coward Theatre. Noel Coward's first West End play, I'll Leave It to You, was performed in this theatre. Anthony Quayle appeared here in Look After Lulu, which Coward had adapted from the Phaedo farce. And it's nice that he's recognised in the West End now.
In their day, both Anthony and Roy were ideally qualified to offer advice to aspiring and established actors. Anthony had an extensive career on stage and on film, appearing in the West End and on Broadway, as well as starring in many of the most iconic films of the 20th century. Anthony's daughter, actress Jenny Quayle, has vivid memories of some of her father's performances and how seriously he took his craft.
The things that he was extraordinary at were being almost an outsider, which actually was sort of what he was. He was most proud of working with people and making a great team and looking after them, the team of the theatre, and brought us up like that. It isn't just the actors. In fact, the actors are just the, you know, icing. It's what's behind it. And from the cutters of the clothes to the, you know, it's, why should, and I remember him saying, why should anybody do anything for you unless you look after them. Why? You know, it's a tough but practical.
Roy was an exceptional comic with outstanding natural timing. Throughout the 60s, 70s and 80s, it seemed that he was never off our screens, appearing in no end of family films, TV drama and sitcoms.
He was actually at the top of his career. He really was. I was in a series and he came in as the guest, the visiting guest. And within a few minutes, he learnt everyone's name, all the crew, the cameraman, the sound guy. He was exactly the same. It was the same kind of feeling of we're all together making this. In our business, reputations always go before you. And there is, if people are a joy, or if people are a pain, or mean, or difficult, it always precedes them. And I have never heard a bad word said against him. Everybody loved him.
The National Youth Theatre is a world-leading youth arts organisation. Established in 1956, they've nurtured the talent of hundreds of thousands of exceptional performers, theatre technicians and writers. Actors Lauren Lyle and Luke Pierre are both recent graduates of the National Youth Theatre's highly regarded repertory company.
We've been so lucky that we've had the chance to have 9 months training and learning about theatre with professionals and doing it on the West End for 3 months. That's unheard of now. Drama schools, I think you get a week a show.
The 3 month run that we do at the end of the rep company is when I learned the most, funnily enough, despite knowing that I had 3 months of sort of every single day learning completely new techniques and things. It was completely amazing. And learning from your peers as well, learning from people that are in the same boat as you and saying, actually, yeah, that's an amazing thing that you just did there. How did you do that? And helping each other.
With rep, we worked with people like the Royal Court and the National and Knee High. All these amazing companies. BBC came in and did radio with us. And we got like tasters of everything that drama school might give you.
That was completely invaluable to me. That was amazing. And it was because of the vocational industry sort of geared training that I don't think I would have gotten if I trained anywhere else.
We were told, chances are, when you're young, you're going to get cast doing something that's quite similar to yourself to begin with, because you have to sort of earn that time of being able to show that you can transform and you can do other things and have the stamina to turn into someone totally different from yourself.
Rep training and sort of forging a career through that type of acting, that type of work really makes you care about companies and really makes you sort of care about, you know, your actor next to you rather than thinking constantly about yourself.
You have to be open to not being a straight route. You don't have to go to drama school. You don't have to do the rep company. Some people will come out and they will work straight away. I think that's the way of the land now, is that there's much less of a path.
Lime Pictures is a major TV production company in the UK, and are producers of the recurring drama Hollyoaks for Channel 4, The Evermore Chronicles for the Disney Channel, and Free Rein for Netflix. Rebecca Hodgson is head of drama, and Peter Hunt is head of casting. They routinely look for acting talent for both new and established productions, and see many of the mistakes that actors make during casting sessions.
The people who have been to the theatre schools feel more confident in themselves, and actually that is an advantage, but I mean, obviously it all costs money.
Talent is talent wherever you might find it. And I think we're almost coming full circle where I, you know, have a huge respect for drama schools. But the reality is that, you know, some really talented young actors can't afford £10,000, £15,000 a year in tuition fees, plus the living expenses being in London, no matter how much they'd love to.
I'm not going to give somebody a job because they went to RADA or they didn't go to RADA or any of the other theatre schools. I think it provides you with discipline. And as I say, that's probably the thing that I keep coming back to, is one of the most important things as an actor. And a great learning curve and a great opportunity to make mistakes.
actors now learn their craft in television. You know, in various soap operas that go out five nights a week that demand and eat up and give actors their first jobs. I think that's where people now learn their craft.
One of the biggest issues that every actor has to face is the enduring challenge of finding work and sustaining a career in what is a highly competitive industry, where the vast majority of actors can be unemployed at any one time.
First of all, learning the rudiments of your job. First of all, trying to fashion some weapons with which to fight, by which I mean technique. These are the elementary problems that any actor faces.
When you say there are 30,000 equity members unemployed at any one moment and he's getting fed up with it, you know, the thing is that they've got other jobs. Anyone, to my mind, who actually earns his living totally as an actor is a successful actor. Otherwise, you're playing at it, you know.
Finding the work really is one of the biggest challenges, and looking at a way to survive as an actor and realising that acting isn't just an episode on television or a part in a play, that it could be voicing a video game.
But I sort of had the assumption that I'd do the company and went really well, had a brilliant time, best year of my life, and I'd come out and I'd start working. And I had good 9 months of rejection, of just getting close, no, not getting close, just auditioning and being told no, at every single corner, and it gets really heartbreaking and gets really, really difficult.
The ability to make money from your voice is certainly a growth that I've seen over the last maybe 10 years. I know actor friends of mine that have literally turned their spare box rooms into soundproof recording studios because actually a job a day is coming in to do voiceovers now, whether that's a voiceover for online golfing or, you know, an online gambling site or a window company. That piece of work can be done from the home, pays them a weekly, a daily income that then allows them to dash off in the afternoon and, you know, go to that interview over in Manchester or in London.
I've got professional jobs from doing rubbish little things on the side that I didn't want to do, and then end up working and going into it, and the director being incredible and young, no one knows director, and then end up 2 years later going and working with them on an amazing project because we got on really well.
I don't think any one job is going to give me another job at all. And that is actually part of the excitement, part of the fear as well.
Whether it's a large international company or a smaller boutique agency, having an agent is more important than ever for actors to find out about new roles that are coming up and to stay in the communication chain with producers.
Agents, I had no agent or anything like that. They were awfully nice. All agents are awfully nice, actually. They say, lovely, lovely, dear boy, come back in 10 years and I think we might be able to use you. I said, well, I could have starved to death in 10 years. And it was literally about 10 years before I got an agent.
I think nowadays that's much, much harder. I do think the world's changed and the industry's changed in that, I mean, I could be wrong, but there seems to be a lot more people in the industry, a lot more actors trying to do it.
I think the role of the agent is very important in that it's a very competitive business. And as much as anything, how do we find our actors? We find our actors because our casting directors send out a brief for a start to agents. So you kind of need to be in the communication chain in order to know that we're auditioning in the first place.
I think where actors let themselves down is that they will generically send bulk emails in the hope that some of it will stick or be picked up. You're more inclined to read somebody that's written to you on a personal level, identified what it is that you're looking for or your tastes, and, you know, changed what it is to suit you. That's interesting.
I think I do honestly, truly believe that stuff creates stuff. And I think if you get yourself in as much as you can, do loads of fringe theatre, things like that, just get yourself in something that an agent can see. From what I've been told and what I've heard is that an agent's not going to look at you unless they've seen you in something. Because, I mean, how can they work for you if they don't know what you can do and they haven't seen you act?
It's not so much better known by the public, it's better known by your potential employers. People, directors would have seen you work, managers would have seen you. And so when they were casting a play, they would think of you.
I think it's about doing your research and knowing that actually the agent that you're with is a reputable one and has access to stuff that you don't, I guess. Otherwise, you may as well be doing it yourself. Personally, I'm a massive fan of actor co-ops because I think it's a very interesting place where you have a hand in your own career whilst understanding the nature of the industry at any one time.
A self-taped audition can be an effective way for producers to open up the pool of actors that they can consider, but the fundamentals of a good audition have not changed, and there are many ways that actors can let themselves down.
I think it's what can you do that nobody else is doing, and don't presume that you're the hardest working actor out there. It's like when people say to me, do I need to learn the lines to come into the audition? I go, that's completely down to you. I don't judge somebody on learning their lines or not, but if you don't, the person after you will have done.
On Free Reign, which is the show we've just made for Netflix, we were desperate to find a character who was sort of nicknamed the Moody Horse Boy. In the week before we got to the read-through, we had two actors who turned up in the room who we liked, and we had Freddie who arrived on a self-tape. We watched him at the end of the day on a computer, and he came in the next day and auditioned with our lead actress and got the role.
To be able to send somebody the script and have them self-tape for you means that somebody is able to audition from the comfort of their own living room, and you are opening up the pool of actors that you're able to consider, which is something that you wouldn't have had time to do years ago.
I think there is a danger that some actors come into an audition and think it's all about them. It's not all about you. It's about how do you portray that character, and how do you become the person we most want portraying that character. So someone who comes in and keeps going, oh, I've messed that up, oh, and it becomes about me, the person, rather than me, the actor, who can be professional. You can say, oh, I'm really sorry, I think I just made a mistake there, can I do it again? That's fine. But we don't need all the emoting that goes with it.
Actually, for many of our directors, it's if I'm stuck doing a night shoot with this person for 14 hours, are they going to be the kind of person at the end of the day that is going to be keeping everybody going? Are they the sort of person I'm going to want to go for a drink with at the end of the day?
If you're auditioning and you're constantly flicking your hair or shaking your head, or there are tricks which become very boring to watch quite quickly and we spot them, you need to be still and natural and inhabit your character. It sounds obvious, but you would be amazed at how many people leave an audition room and we look at each other and go...
What with innovative technology, new online platforms, and so many accessible venues all opening up the entertainment landscape, it seems that there are now more opportunities for actors to create their own work than ever before, no matter what their age or background.
Dad was always extremely hardworking, and he decided what he wanted to do in, well, he must have been in his 70s, wasn't he? Late 60s, 70s, when he started, 70s. Started his own theatre company, and that it would go on tour and then it would come into the West End. And the first play they did was The Clandestine Marriage. The fact that it was called Compass, because, you know, he was always sailing, and the idea that you have your own inner compass, that, you know, will point whichever way and you've got to go, was him.
There are so many venues that are detached from the world of amateur dramatics, but are offering performers the opportunity to gain experience on stage, and I love going to those fringe venues as a means to see not only new acting talent but new writing talent. And it's interesting that the people that you saw in those, you know, theatre above a pubs, that were a bunch of graduates graduating from drama school 5 years ago that didn't have work, were creating their own work. Actually, now you sit and go through those programmes and see there's so-and-so working at the Royal Exchange, so-and-so working at the National, so-and-so in this TV programme. So I think it's about actors coming together to create, as they always have done, their own companies and finding those fringe venues.
I'm really excited to be working in all different mediums, in all different types of forms, such as video game. Now that is really quite big, especially for actors, whether it's just 3D motion capture or if it's actually sort of the pinpoints on the face and acting in that.
the introduction of Netflix and Amazon into the European market and the global market also marks a different level in the playing field. When a lot of people were shouting and complaining about BBC Three moving to the iPlayer, I thought they were completely out of touch, and actually, of course, BBC Three should be on the iPlayer. And if and because I've got kids at home, one of whom is 13, I knew that she'd stopped watching traditional television several years ago.
With kids, to feel that they can make their own movies, and they can, because they're all pretty versant with computers. Feel, make their own movies, they can cut, they can edit, they can do stuff from Titchy, you know, that is where the future will be.
The advice being offered by actors and producers today does not seem to have changed that much from the advice given by Anthony and Roy over 30 years ago. When I recorded the interviews with them back in 1984, there were just 4 TV channels in the UK. Today, there's over 400. But in this rapidly changing industry, what's it going to take to get established and sustain a career in what is still one of the world's most precarious professions?
Patience and resilience. That's what you need to be an actor. That's what I think you do need to be an actor, is patience and resilience, because it's not going to come quickly. It certainly hasn't come quickly for me.
Acting is as much about natural talent as about what you can learn or what someone can teach you. And in some ways, you've either got that or you haven't.
I think it demands that you've got to be really committed to your craft and to wanting to be actors. I don't think it's a career for the faint-hearted.
It's a hell of a profession, I think. I think it's a very difficult one. I think it's one that attracts a whole lot of people who shouldn't be in it at all. And therefore, the more difficult you make it, the better it is.
If you get a job, you've got the research you have to put into doing that job. It's a period drama, learn about that time. You have to develop a whole entire new person to inhabit and really become and do it truthfully. You have to work with everyone else. You have to learn your lines. That takes ages. You've got to read and read and read.
So I think it's really looking at how you can stretch your own skills and being really proactive if you want to stay in this career, because it isn't for somebody who's faint-hearted or who thinks they'd like to try it, you know, give it a try and see how they get on. You've got to be absolutely dedicated and be ready, you know, to be out of work for a long period of time and be okay with that.
There will be times, however good you are, where you might need to just get a job in between, but still make yourself available for interviews.
You've got to be prepared to have a little grip pack with 2 pairs of underpants, get on any bus anywhere to any job and do it, which one was for many years. You know.
The only advice I can give you is just don't stop. You have to just keep going, however hard it is.
To actors that are in their teens, that are at school and things like that, I'd really recommend them to try everything that they can in youth theatres, local sort of exhibitions, live art, anything that they can get a sort of taste or an experience in it, and to try do as many different things as possible.
I think you have to be really confident in yourself and your ability and your talent, and sort of delude yourself that you're amazing and tell yourself that you're great, because no one else is going to tell you.
For those who are bloody-minded enough, because I think it comes down to that in the end. You know, talent's very common. But actually, have you got the right nature? Have you got this sort of, you know, I think it is, as Shakespeare says, o perseverance, you know. Have you got that? Because that will see you through. The other bit, that.
It had better be a way of life, which in itself, just to belong to it, just to strive, is enough. Which means you're not going to make a lot of money, and you're going to be out of work an awful lot of time, and you're not going to have any glamour at all, but it's just got to be something you want above anything else in the world you want to do. Then go to it, and you have my full encouragement.
I really hate talking about this business as business, and I really hate it when people start using business speak, but unfortunately even I have to remember sometimes it is a business, and that's sort of what we're all doing. It is, ultimately, it's not a hobby.
What is acting? I mean, what actually is the art? Why should they say that you can act and I can't? It's just so many people sitting there going, he's good or he's no good, but why should they? You know, it's such a stupid business. I mean, if you're a musician, you can either play the instrument or not. I mean, you've got annotations, you've got things that you can actually do. I mean, what is acting? I don't know. It's a ludicrous business.